We're glad that part of our fellowship is the people on live stream. Tonight we're going to begin the fifth chapter of Luke. This will be our 17th exposition of this book. And there's a lot of things we'll see here tonight. It's more than just an account. As you know, in Christ's life, the truth was being lived out. And so we're learning about truth. This will be Luke 5, the first 11 verses. And it came to pass, as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two ships standing by the lake. But the fishermen were gone out of them and were fishing and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let your nets down for a draught. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their nets brake. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both ships, so they began to sink. And Simon Peter saw it. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, and saying, Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he was astonished, and all that were with him at the draught of the fishes which they had taken. And so also was James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said unto Simon, Fear not, from henceforth thou shalt catch men. And when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed him. And I'm very interested in these texts, this kind of text, because it's commenting on people and their response to a Christ. It's not a USA response. It's not a church response. You'll have to live a while before you confront anybody that responds to Jesus like this. But this is the only proper response to Jesus you're reading about. Now Jesus, you'll notice, only called his disciples once. That's all. They didn't come on the first call. All of them came the first call. One call, not a repeated call. Their action meant, in this case, to abandon a joint business. You know, it wasn't like homeless people following Jesus. It wasn't like that. It involved them abandoning their business and following Jesus. Now, there was a purpose in the ministry of Jesus that is kind of underneath the surface or in the background. People as large didn't know God. They were unacquainted with God, even though he'd worked with the nation for 1,500 years. They were fundamentally unacquainted with God. And so in Christ's ministry, the people were exposed. Now here's some of the things. They were exposed to the wisdom of God. See, when he actually worked it out in front of their eyes, the love of God, the compassion of God. See, this was lived out. This stuff was lived. This wasn't just words. This was lived out. Amen. The mercy of God was lived out. And you saw the vast gulf between God and men. You could see it in how different Jesus was from people. That was telling you there's a big gulf between God and man. Here's his son, and he looks like a man. That's about it. That's about the only comparison you could draw. And you saw the power of God. They introduced to his power. God can do anything he wants, whenever he wants, wherever he wants. The will of God, they were introduced to that, that God's will always prevails. Amen. When it comes to exerting the will, men can exert their will, but God can out-exert them. That's the way it is. And you saw what priorities were, what was important. You saw it with the ministry of Jesus. And you saw the Father himself in Jesus. You saw true spirituality. What did it mean to be spiritual? Well, here you saw it in Jesus. You saw God's long-suffering. You saw God's intolerance with sin and bigotry and dullness and faithlessness. And see, it all was demonstrated. Of course, forgiveness, and there's a lot of other things, too. This was God manifest in the flesh. Amen. His name, Jesus' name, was Emmanuel, God with us. See, so it was... Man, we're getting a glimpse, a sort of a snapshot of God. Some people liked what they saw and some people didn't. That's because they either were attracted to or repelled by God. See, their response to Jesus betrayed what their response to God was. That's why Jesus said, "He that hath seen me hath seen the Father." You're attracted to Jesus, you're attracted to God. Amen. You're repelled by Jesus, turned off by Jesus, you're repelled, turned off by God. So they were facing with a person that correlated what he saw with who God was. Now this is the big difficulty man has, men and women. They have trouble correlating who God is with what they're dealing with. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, the more you grow up into Christ, the more you can do this. The more of a novice you are, the less you can do this. But the majority of people can't connect who God is with what the circumstance they're in. They can't put the two together and make some sense out of it. So Jesus lived out what happened to a person who did this. Jesus did this, and he lived it out before the people. Now, he begins by telling us that the people, it came to pass. I've commented on this phrase often. This is like God's calendar language. In scriptures, what God was doing, that's what the text is about. The text isn't about what man was doing or what man was or what man wanted. The text of scripture is about what God is doing. And it came to pass means in God's agenda, what God was doing, this was the next thing on the agenda. Yeah. Came to pass. See, Jesus lived in the center of God's will. Yeah. Yeah. As you grow up into Christ, you'll begin doing this more. You'll live in the heart of God's will. Until this happens, you're living in the center of your own will. Or if you're a real fearful, timorous person, you'll pick out some like a super person, you'll live in their will. See? But the more you grow up into Christ, see, this is why mega leaders that lead great billions of people, the people think that person can do their thinking for them, which is exactly what that person wants them to think. See? But when God's on the scene, God does what he wants. And he insists that men see this. If you don't see this, you make no headway at all in life. Jesus saw it. He said, "I only do what I see the Father doing." So it came to pass. This is God's agenda being worked out. And what happened? The people pressed upon him. Crowded up. Crowded around him, pushed near to be near him. See, the people, why we're doing it, this is God. See, God's drawing the people in.
Yeah, amen.
God can do this anytime he wants. Mm-hmm. I won't question it for a minute. God can do this anytime he wants. He can lift the veil from Israel's eyes and they come.
That's right.
He can do this. He left the veil from an individual or from a body of people like a Pentecost or submitted city of Samaria. He can do it to one person, a lot of people. He can do this to a whole nation if he wants. He can just all of a sudden, just everything makes sense. Mm-hmm. The people pressed him. There's a sense of urgency in this too, where the word contains a sense of urgency. It was, I'm sure they were curious, but it was more than curiosity. This was a phenomenon that was happening that hadn't been around them. Jesus, notice they pressed upon him, and it's going to say to hear him. Yeah. Not to see him, mm-hmm. to hear him. Mm-hmm. That's what it says, to hear him. So Jesus had become a noted speaker.
Yeah.
He was noted for what he said. Even though he did miracles, but he's noted primarily for what he said. They pressed in to hear him. He was riveting, evidently. He was a riveting speaker. Now, he wasn't commenting on the shenanigans of Herod and Pilate, you know. This wasn't his comment. Or the need for moral reform. Things are going down the tube here. This isn't what he came to tell. He came preaching the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
That's what it says, the kingdom of God. Mm-hmm. That's mentioned 54 times in the Gospels, the kingdom of God. The kingdom of heaven, which is Matthew's term, is mentioned 32 times. And the kingdom, just after, is mentioned 14 times. So that's that's a lot of mentions of the kingdom of God. It's interesting that we hear so little of it today. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
Today, they say kingdom of God, they're talking about eschatology.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Well, there's nobody that I know of that talks of a public stature that talks of the kingdom of God like being here. Uh-huh. But it is.
Yeah, amen.
Jesus preached it. He told him it's near. God's good. He told Jacob, I'm going to set it up. Mm-hmm. Told Daniel, he's going to set up a kingdom. Jesus, it's just about here. And it happened, the day of Pentecost is set up.
That's right.
The only thing important in the world, truly important, when you get down to the bottom line important, the only thing important is what God is doing. That's
Amen.
Then however you fit into that, that gives some importance to what you're doing. But if what you're doing doesn't fit into that, you're a nobody, and what you're doing is of no consequence whatsoever in the scheme of things.
That's a good point. You know, it wasn't until Jesus was provoked by the religious leaders that he ever really talked about the corruption.
That's right.
Of the religious system.
That's
and,
right.
And usually, when they were in the crowd and were staring at the people, that he talked directly to them and to their corrupt ways.
Yes.
Otherwise, he didn't. Say a whole lot about
No, he
that.
Didn't. Mm-hmm. Told his disciples, beware of them, you know. And the leaven of Herod, to beware
yes.
of that.
Uh-huh.
But that's what this is what he came to do. He didn't come as a moral reformer. John the Baptist now was the first person to actually preach about the kingdom of God. Some of the prophets mentioned the kingdom, but nobody preached about it. Mm-hmm. Daniel interpreted a dream to one man. About it. But John the Baptist preached the kingdom of God. And Jesus preached the kingdom of God. And Paul preached the kingdom of God. I mean, this is categorically stated.
Yeah.
What it is, as I say, it's interesting how little is said about the kingdom of God these days. Toward the end of his ministry, after he raised Lazarus from the dead, the Pharisees observed this concerning their vain attempts. See, while he's preaching the kingdom of God, nobody could put a hand on him or anything. They just couldn't do it. And here's what they observed. And a great multitude followed him because they saw the miracles. But before that, just a second here. Yes, John 12:19, just toward the end of his ministry. The Pharisees therefore said among themselves, "Perceive ye how ye prevail nothing? Behold, the world's gone after him." See, there was nothing they could do about it. They couldn't shrink these crowds. They wanted to and they tried to, but they couldn't. This was God. See, this was God's work. This was God telling you, if you got trouble believing that the knowledge of God can cover the earth as the waters cover the sea, let me give you a little sample of what I can do. Without any kind of advertisement, I can make the people come out and hear my son. If you have trouble, and some people do, they say, that's not going to happen. If you got trouble with that, Jesus lived out. God has no trouble with this at all. Well, what does it mean to preach the kingdom of God? Well, boiled down to its essence, it means you declare what God is doing.
Yeah, amen.
His purpose of what he's doing. If you declared the rule of the United States, you'd tell what it's doing. But this is what it does. In the history of the church, there's been several back-to-back centuries when this message almost disappeared. There's been stretches of human history of hundreds of years, several centuries, when there was no measurable proclamation of the kingdom of God. It's phenomenal. They call them the dark ages, so forth. But there's been periods, and we have now entered into another one of those periods. We're in this kind of a period right now. It says probably in its beginning stage, but the theological world is becoming a desert, a vast desert. And some people don't like to hear this because there's so many mega churches and all this, but they have up here on Route 44, there's fag bearing out there. It's a big manufacturing concern. When I was head of the maintenance department, we used to buy our needle bearings from that company, fag bearing. Now, fag bearing built a plant that size in Carthage, and he opened it up Monday morning for 1 hour, and then he shut it down. What do you think the people would think? They say, "What is going on?"
Yeah.
That's what the churches are doing.
Yeah, that's right.
That is what they are doing.
Uh-huh.
No worldly business would ever conduct itself like the church conducts its business.
Uh-huh.
No, it would never do it. See.
Uh-huh.
But my point is, when God's at work,
uh-huh,
it's not that way. Now, at first, I don't question when the people flocked out to hear Jesus. There was a sort of a novelty to it, I don't doubt, that they were enamored by his preaching. He sure didn't speak like the scribes. They picked up on that right away. Didn't speak like the scribes. See, behind the scenes, though, God's drawing, teaching people to believe he can do this. See, drawing the people. During a really dead spiritual time, the people were sitting in darkness.
Yeah.
It was a spiritually dead, desolate time.
Yeah.
And during this time, here's these people flocking out to hear Jesus. And when they get out, everyone pressing to get close to him, and we're going to find they pushed him right up to the edge of the lake.
Yeah.
The fact that now Jesus never did open up the truth to these people. He only opened it up to the disciples. He just kind of tell enough so you had to, anyone interested had to ask for further information.
Yeah.
And some people apparently did. Boy, standing by the Lake of Gennesaret, that's another name for the Sea of Galilee, or the Lake of Tiberias, that's all the same place. He's standing by this body of water. This event's recorded and it's called Sea of Galilee. Here it's called the Sea of Gennesaret. Matthew 4:18 calls it the Sea of Galilee. Same event. See, it's the same body of water called by different names. Here's some little facts about the Sea of Galilee. It was a pretty good piece of water. Easton's Bible Dictionary says it's 12.5 miles long, 4 to 7.5 miles wide. That's where they rowed across in a storm. 4 miles on land is one thing, 4 miles on water is something else. 4 miles in a storm on water, that's definitely something else. Yeah. It's 682 feet beneath the Mediterranean sea level, which I understand is very unusual. One of the lowest bodies of water in the world. Its depth is from 80 to 160 feet. Jordan River emptied into this river about 26 miles from its source. There's a fall in the river bed, of 1,682 feet. And it falls at the rate of more than 60 feet to the mile. So it's very unusual body of water. 60 miles northeast of Jerusalem. It's an oval shape, and it's to this day, it's noted for its astounding number of fish that live in it. It's lake water and it's sweet water. The Gospels refer to it 5 times as the Sea of Galilee, 2 times as the Sea of Tiberias, and once as the Lake of Gennesaret. This massive body of water, I've shown some pictures there on page 3, so you get an idea of what a large a body of water it was. Now there he is, and they pressed him to the edge, and they just keep pushing him to hear him. And he saw two ships standing by the lake, docked, we'd say docked. 2 boats lying at the edge of the lake. Now, that's an interesting thing. See how alert Jesus was? Now here's this crowd's pressing in on him. This would have camped the ordinary person. This is all he could have thought about. They wouldn't see any kind of opportunity or anything going on the side. You see how alert Jesus was? He saw two boats standing up there docked on the shore. Alertness. See, when a person's affections are set on things above, it actually makes him more alert. But the general conception is they're made less alert. So this idiot saying, don't be so heavenly minded, you're no earthly good. See, that comes from a total lack of familiarity with the nature of spiritual life. Spiritual life does not make a person dull. Or unaware of what's going on around the bottom. I know there's people like this now, Christian people like this. They just don't know what's going on. That's all. They had never seen these two ships. Now Jesus saw them. He was alert. Spiritual mindedness will do that for you. Fellowship with Christ will do that for you. It'll make you more keenly alert of your surroundings, and you'll be able to know what to do with where you're at. That posture, as I understand it, must be maintained so you don't become vulnerable. You'll be caught off guard. If you don't know what's going on around you to some degree, you'll be caught off guard. And being with the Lord will make you that alert. And he noted that the fishermen, they were not in the boats. They were going out of the boats. They were washing their nets. So he sees they weren't being used, see? Look what all he saw. He saw they were over there washing their nets. And so he determined he is going to use these ships. See, in our time, there's a form of Christianity being cultured that does not allow this kind of thing. This is particularly true among the younger generation and the moves that are toward them. These young people are just dull. They don't know what's going on. They're entertainment centered. And that's how the world appeals to them, see? Mm-hmm. That's why I'm so thankful for our young people here.
Yeah, amen.
Now, they're different from other young people, just in this regard. They're alert. They can reason about things. They can see opportunities, see? That's good.
Yeah.
But it's a bad... This has been cultured now by the churches are largely responsible for culturing religious young people this way. People have been mesmerized like a, they're like in a hypnotic state with entertainment. You know, they just hear a certain kind of music that just changes their whole world.
Yeah.
Here's someone beating on a log, a little rhythm, you know, and boy, that changes everything. Mm-hmm. But that's not the kind of people these people were. So he entered into one of the ships, and it belonged to Peter, and he'd met Peter before this, remember? Andrew brought him to Jesus, and that's where he named him, Cephas. So he'd met him before. Mm-hmm. We don't know exactly how long, but it's fairly recently. Mm-hmm. As he got in the boat, and then Peter evidently was right at hand there, so he prayed him that he'd thrust out a little from the land. Now you can imagine, now put yourself in this is your boat. Mm-hmm. It's not like a little rowboat. It's a fishing boat. Mm-hmm. I'd gather that this is one of these boats or what they went across the sea on, you know, and there were 13 people, counting Jesus, in the boat, so it wasn't like a little dungey or whatever they call it. It was a fair-sized boat. Mm-hmm. It's your boat sitting on the shore, and his teacher gets in your boat and tells you to push off, or some versions say row out, mm-hmm. push off. I thought about that. Pretty good-sized vessel, I mean. Took something to push that thing out, but don't push out a little bit from the shore. And he did. He pushed it out a little from the shore. Jesus sat down in the boat and worked a few miracles for the people. No, I'm sorry. And taught the people.
That's right.
And he taught the people. He sat down and taught the people out of the ship.
Yeah.
He taught the people. What does that mean, taught the people? Mm-hmm. The Greek lexicons are pretty weak on this right here. They say it was to hold a discourse with others in order to instruct them and deliver didactic discourses. But I like the English definition, which tells it the truth. To cause to know something, to cause to know how, to accustom to some action. And he taught them about the things of God, the kingdom of God. He acquainted them with the things of God. This is what Moses did this. This is what, see, men of God have always done this. They've taken the things of God and they've taught the people. They didn't teach the people about what's going on in the world.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They didn't teach the people about human potential. Instead of Moses, and Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the judgments. So after he'd been up there and received all the ceremonial law, all the law, and all the, how to build a tabernacle, and all this. He told the people all those words. And it's the kind of thing Samuel did when he called the people together and told them the manner of the kingdom.
Yeah.
See? Explained to them about how a kingdom works. The Levites did this in the days of Nehemiah. They read in the book of the law of God distinctly and gave the sense and caused them to understand the reading. See, this is teaching.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm sure you're aware of this, and maybe you experienced it personally. Some people, they've gone to church for years, but they don't understand the Bible.
Yeah.
The preachers don't teach them to understand the scriptures. Why not? Well, you can't like build a career on this.
Mm-hmm.
You can't make an institution on this, or a money gathering organization. You can't do. But this is what men of God have always done. They've taken what God said and they made sure it was within the grasp of the people. Whoever wanted to understand it would be able to know what it meant. And what is what Jesus did too when he taught the two on the road to Emmaus. Here's some example of teaching. He expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. See, that's teaching. This is what Philip did when he's with the eunuch.
Mm-hmm.
He opened his mouth, began with the same scripture, and preached unto him Jesus. That's teaching. That's what teaching is. See, that's what it is. Teaching is an attack on ignorance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank God there's such a thing.
Yeah.
It enlarges the scope of knowledge, so the person who's taught knows more.
Yeah, amen. Yeah.
comprehends more. It's not ever related to entertainment or the promotion of sectarian views or things of this sort. It deals with the people gaining that familiarization with the knowledge of God and God himself and his kingdom. They become familiar so they can handle these things, work with them. Now, expressions that reflect this manner of teaching, here are some of them. Jesus would say, the kingdom of heaven is like unto. And he's teaching him. He's showing him some aspect. He said, whereunto shall we liken the kingdom of God? So he's teaching him. He wants the people to comprehend it. He taught them many things. He expounded all things. Preaching and showing the glad tidings of the kingdom. He spake unto them of the kingdom of God. And he spoke about telling them of heavenly things. See, this is teaching. That's what it is. It's teaching. Now, I wanted to say a word about the impact of sin on the human race that requires this kind of teaching. Sin throws a shroud over the truth of God. Now, this will happen to if a person sins, he's less able to understand the things of God. This is the washer. Now, they may say they do, but they're not telling the truth.
That's right.
Sin clouds the truth so the people don't understand it.
Yeah.
That's the effect of truth. That's why truth has to be taught. People can't just, like, discover. They can't go home and read their Bible and just discover it. It's not that simple, because sin has robbed them of, first of all, a desire, and second of all, of an understanding. So someone must explain it. How can I? I've been reading the Bible here.
Yeah.
The Ethiopian eunuch says that I don't know what I'm. Is this man talking about himself or some other man? He had to have somebody explain it. That's what sin did to the human race. God looked down upon the human race. He gave his assessment. There's none that understands. Ain't nobody come up from one of the nations. So wait, we got some people over here that understand. There's none that understand.
Yeah.
He waited till the law had been in place for several hundred years before he said that. Psalmist said he looked down from heaven to see if there were any that did understand. And then he gave the verdict. There's not one. That's why people have to be taught.
Amen.
I can see, I probably was in this state myself. This is not how people that are religious leaders think. They don't think like this. But what sin has done to the people, someone's got to open a thing up. But that is what has to happen. Somebody has to, so that's why he ordained preaching as the means. Mm-hmm. To the foolishness of preaching to say that they believe. That's the means. Mm-hmm. And preaching is almost synonymous with teaching. It just accents the proclamation of it. So the impact of sin. Situation is so bad that God selected one unique body of people. Set his love upon them, and he didn't set it on anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
He gave them a law which he didn't give to anybody else.
Yeah.
He sent them prophets which he didn't send to anybody else. He worked with them. And then this was his assessment of this nation that he spent time working with. My people is foolish. They have not known me. They are sottish children, and they have none understanding. They are wise to do evil, but to do good they have no knowledge. See? Men did not need to be given additional information. That's not what they needed. They needed to be made suitable to receive additional information. So he gave them the law, through the law came the knowledge of sin. Now they could become acquainted with sin. In Scripture, teaching addresses this situation of spiritual ignorance. See, teaching addresses that situation head on. Those who major in things like addressing the renewal problem, making people different in political and domestic and governmental, and they address those sort of things. They actually have created roadblocks. They haven't helped anything. The world thinks they've helped them. So they'll pay them big money. They can help them keep their marriage together. Well, I tell you right now, that's not why Jesus died. That's not why this investment salvation is made. If you can get man corrected, he'll correct these. He'll correct these situations. And God will work with him in the doing of it. When Jesus taught in parables, he did so because the people, they couldn't receive the truth. But it did sound like he was speaking about agriculture or the proper handling of wine or how to prepare a feast and invite people to it. Or what do you do about a wayward son? Or how do you build a house? On the surface, this sounds like what he was talking about. But this isn't what he was talking about. And it would later, when people's eyes were opened up, they could look back at these parables. Well, you did yourself, didn't you? There came a time you looked back, and all of a sudden, hey, you could see what it was saying. It was a shrouded form of teaching.
You're going to say this, but that just caused me to think about how some people do get up and supposedly teach, and they're teaching these things that sound like parables, don't they?
That's right.
Talking about the wealth, you know, be wealthy in the world, all these things, and it sounds just like the parables.
That's exactly it.
They don't even see.
And he didn't talk this way to his disciples.
That's right.
And the disciples wondered why he didn't. They said, why do you talk in parables to them but not to us? He didn't talk that way to them. Which means that's not his preferred way of communication.
Yeah.
His parables, he was like sowing some seed. Now, through the centuries, the professed church has been deficient in teaching. Through the centuries, this has been so. So that there's been times in history when teaching surfaced again and some attention was paid to it. But as a rule, and the deficiency in teaching was the door that was open to false teachers. As soon as the teaching became deficient, the door was opened to charlatans and false teachers and this sort of thing. When existing elders heap people under themselves, what Paul said they would do, that opened the door for evil men to creep in unawares.
Yeah, that's right.
So flawed teaching is why this apostasy has occurred.
Yeah, amen.
We're talking at a practical level now. Why it has occurred. Even though Paul instructed Timothy, he said, now this was Paul's instruction. Here's how you address this teaching thing. You got a good teacher here now. Someone's really teaching. All right. Now this teaching can't die when this man dies. So he said, now the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach, who shall be able to teach.
Yeah.
Make arrangements to do this, Timothy. But the church didn't do this, so they decided, let's hand this over to an institute. Well, at an institute. Oh, that's what they did.
Yeah.
But that's not what This is not, they said we're doing it because the church isn't doing so, but I guess it didn't dawn on anyone, duh. Maybe if we start preaching and teaching like we should, apparently people didn't. Not on any scale anyway. So they handed over to the training institutions, they handed over what the preachers and teachers were to be doing. It's a real trait of institutions to major in careers and professionals. You can't have an institution without this. You cannot have a human institution without this kind of emphasis, because that's what drives the institution, see? But this is not the type of thing. So with the institution, they create new positions that God didn't say to the church. Because what God said to the church, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, so forth, they can't advance the institution. So we're going to have to advance some office. This is what happened. People may object to saying this, but this is the truth.
Yeah. Yeah.
They won't advance. They can't advance the institution with these gifts that God has given.
Right.
So they create their own offices, which will advance the institution.
Right.
And to me, that's serious. Now, those who are juvenile in their understanding, they're the ones who are tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. So if you've got this institutional froth, it's actually producing people that are vulnerable.
Yeah.
That's what this non-teaching type emphasis, it produces people that they cannot avoid this now. Children are, beginners in their understanding, are tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. And the solution to that isn't teaching them more doctrine. The solution is grow up. That's the solution. And teaching lends itself there. All right, Jesus has got into the boat, sat down, taught the people, and then finally it's like the Father said, all right, we've said enough now.
Yeah.
When he left speaking, there comes a time when there comes a time when you quit talking to Felix. Paul quits talking to Felix. There comes a time when he quits talking to the Athenians. And it came time for Jesus, it was time that he'd said what needed to be said. Time to move along, so he left speaking.
Yeah.
And so he turns to Peter and he says, launch out into the deep. Simon, says Simon, launch out into the deep. We got to get away from the shore here.
Yeah.
Now, if you've ever been any time around a large body of water, you know that all the minnows and the filth and all that, that's up near the shore. You want the pure water, you gotta get out away from the shore. Row out into the deep. They're going to let down their net for a great catch. Now, the natural history of Bible says this of the fish in the depths of the Sea of Galilee. The thickness of the shoals of fish is almost incredible to anyone who has not witnessed them. They often cover an area more than an acre. And when the fish move slowly forward in a mass and are rising out of the water, they are packed so close together that it appears as if heavy rain was beating down on the surface of the water. And I read that this has been up for hundreds of years to this very day in 2000 and whatever year we got, 15.
Mm-hmm.
It's still this way.
Mm-hmm.
This lake is noted. So when Jesus said on the Sea of Galilee, let down your net for a draught. I mean, that would tell you something right there.
Yeah.
the circumference of the Sea of Galilee is 37 miles. The waters are as deep as 140 feet. As I mentioned, it's fresh water with freshwater fish that are abundance have all through the years. Any city around the Sea of Galilee was a fishing port. To this day, it's still noted for its fish. 1993, a Mendel Nunn published an article in Biblical Archaeology in which he listed the species of fish that are in the Sea of Galilee. He listed 18, but there were several of them that are particularly for eating. He named them here. And they were in abundance. When you caught these, they were in a phenomenal abundance. And he said, launch out into the deep and let, not cast. Yeah, one time when they were on the Sea of Galilee in the John 21, he told them to cast their net. See, you cast it, then you drag, you cast the net, and then you pull it back in. Here you let the net down. I gather that the waters are deep there, and the Lord had made this cluster of fish down there, so just let your net. You do have to know where to let your net down. You all know that, don't you? You can let your net down in Proverbs and you'll just get a few fish. I'm not bad-mouthing Proverbs. I'm just telling you the perspective. You let your net down in Romans or Ephesians or Hebrews. You'll find there's a big school. School of fish down there. Let down your nets for a draught. Some versions say for a catch. Draught, it means a large number of fish. Draught is to fish what flock is to sheep or herd is to cattle. That's what you call a lot of fish, draught, see? So a large number of fish will not congregate on the surface. If you have a large number of fish on the surface, they'd be spread out. You gotta drag your net through that. But when you let your net down, the fish are just kind of waiting by divine demanding. The fish are waiting to get in the net. So let your net down. Now there's a spiritual parallel here. If you want to obtain some meaningful spiritual provisions, you're going to have to launch out into the deep. You can't be dabbling around in shallow water. Those who frolic in spiritual shallowness are always infants. Just talk to them for a while and you'll pick up on this very easily. There is a similarity to earthly waters. Slime is always on the shore. You don't see slime out in the middle. It's the waves pick it up from the floor and wash it up to the shore. See? And then up in the shore, if you want little bitty fish, you used to take the kids to Lake Michigan, little bitty fish, you get up by the shore, and little bitty minnows, you know, they're about a half an inch max in length. But they're always, you never see those out in the deep. You never see minnows out there. You see the minnows up there. Now listen, some people are always catching spiritual minnows. That's all they ever get. Some little bitty something. A minnow's a minnow's a real fish. It's a real fish. But not exactly meant for consumption. So it's not that what people find isn't true, it's just like, so what? You know, it doesn't make any measurable difference. Charlatans and opportunists are always on the shore. Always are. You won't find them on the deep. There's something about a spiritual fisherman who spends time in the deep, it brings a sort of a sobriety to them. And a respect for the truth of God. You'll notice that in your own studies, you should notice it. As you're plowing in the significant things, it has an impact on your spirit.
Sometimes you can use the minnows to catch a bigger fish. But you got to catch that bigger fish in a little deeper water.
That's right.
That's good.
Well, Simon, what are you going to do? Simon says, well, Master, we've toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Toiled. Yeah, that's a word of weariness. We've been fishing all night. Remember what we took to fish? Throw the net out, pull the net in, throw the net out, pull. See, so this is exhausting work. All night. Yeah. We didn't come up, we have not even landed one fish. But nevertheless, see if you will stay in the presence of Jesus, if you will just stay there, and not run away to some other distraction, you will do what he says.
Amen.
Now this will happen. But some people they never stay with Jesus long enough for anything significant to happen in their life. Wasn't so with Peter. Nevertheless. Now there's something else to note here. It says that these men were washing their nets. Remember that? Which means their nets got defiled while they were catching nothing. Something come up on their nets, but it wasn't fish. And you will notice in your spiritual life, when you don't catch anything, that there's something defiling that happens to you. This is just what happens. So that's an interesting thing to note. Now, I'll give you an example of this. You take the Day of Atonement, which was the highest of all Jewish days. They offered multiple sacrifices unto God, but they didn't catch anything. See? But their conscience was defiled, except they didn't have any way to cleanse them. See? So a fruitless, here's how it works. A fruitless spiritual activity will make you spiritually dirty. You can't come away from wasting your time without being defiled. And fortunately, in Christ, there's a cleansing to be had from that kind of defilement. See, this is not defilement that happens by moral infractions of the law. It's not that kind. It's the kind of just being, having too much of the world and not catching anything. It defiles you. Big lesson to learn. Of course, Peter, showing his caliber, he said, nevertheless. But, in other words, here's the circumstance. We are, frankly, are tired. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But we're going to do what you said.
Yeah,
anyway.
Amen.
At thy word, I'll let down the net.
That's right.
Even though it contradicted experience,
yes,
and it contradicted reason.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. I'm still going to do it.
And these were experienced.
Yeah, so I was going to say, this is your experienced fishermen.
Yeah.
That's right. So they really were toiling. It was they were just
that's
pretending
right.
at it. They really were toiling. They really wore out.
I get the impression
that he's saying that he wouldn't have done it for anybody.
That's right.
Yeah.
Exactly
yeah.
right. Uh-huh. This is the first recorded response of Peter to something Jesus told him to do. And we don't have any result of him refusing to do what Jesus told him to do. Not that I know of, anyway. Every believer has got to get to the point. If you're not there now, you got to get there. Has to get to the point where they act upon what Jesus says and do it in right away.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Sometimes a thought will occur to you, a thought of a get up and do it thought will occur to you in an inopportune moment. Maybe you're in bed or someplace.
Uh-huh.
You've got to master the art of getting up and doing it.
Yeah, amen.
Otherwise, you miss.
Yes.
You miss something. The children of Abraham must do as their father did.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Offer your son Isaac as a burnt offering to me. Early in the morning, he gets up, cuts the wood, loads the cart, heads off. See, he
yeah.
obeyed immediately. Children of Abraham should do the same thing. No one will ever know what God can do until they do what he tells them to do.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
Now ponder the following about Peter. He's received some bad press, so I thought I'd better make a few comments about him. He was among the very first, Jesus said, follow me. So he was one of the first ones. He's the first apostle. In any listing of the apostles, his name appears first. He always is represented as a leader among the disciples. He's like a spokesman and a leader. He is a member of the inner circle, Peter, James, and John, and he was a leader of the inner circle. First mentioned there. He's also noted for asking questions. He asked a lot of questions of the Master. He's the first to confess that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of the living God. He's the only apostle who ever walked on water.
Yeah.
He's the only disciple Jesus asked to sift, of record anyway. He's the first one to preach to the Jews. And he's the first one to preach to the Gentiles. Yet in spite of all these distinctives, men consistently represent him as a bungling disciple.
Yeah.
Phenomenal. You wonder if they even read the Bible. You wonder if they even read the Bible. Well, I think actually, to be fair, people say that because they heard someone else say it.
Yeah, I think so.
But you can see there's nothing in the scripture that leads you to the conclusion that he always stuck his foot in his mouth all the time.
Yeah.
He was called the
rock.
Yeah.
The
yeah.
rock, amen. Even renamed him.
Would be there.
Yeah. And Satan doesn't waste his time going after somebody who's unimportant.
That's right.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. Well, when they let down the net, when they had this done, they enclosed a great number of fish. I think what they had to do to do this, they'd been cleansing their nets. They had to get some nets and put them back in the boat. They had to get the boat in the deep water, mm-hmm. and they had to let down the net into the water. So all of that took some activity. And so, but all of, it doesn't go through all what was all the steps they had to go through to do this. And this is characteristic of the Holy Spirit. It's like a very difficult thing that was done. They don't tell all the steps yeah. that led up to it. They don't talk that way.
Yeah, but given
the person who is in the process of obeying the Lord, he'll know all the steps.
Oh, yeah.
See, he'll benefit from each one of those steps. He'll be able to see and fellowship with the Lord. But when you comment on it like this, see, it's not, it would be hard. Well, to try to keep up with all of them.
It would glorify the steps.
That's right, yes.
Yeah. Now, it's true that men must obediently respond to the words of Jesus if they expect to reap the promised benefits. If you expect to have what Jesus promised, you got to do what he required.
Yes, amen.
Now, I call this the including of accompaniments. There's certain things that we're told to do that are to be accompanied by other things. Let me name a few of them for you. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. See? You got to include just as sure as they had to load the nets and push the boat, you got to have the accompaniments. I will therefore that men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. See? There you are. That's an accompaniment. Let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith. So forth. See? Whom having not seen ye love, and whom though now ye see him not yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Mm-hmm. Not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together as a manner of some, but exhorting, what's the accompaniment? That ye with one mind and mouth might glorify God. Which things also we speak, not in words of man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth. Let's keep the feast not with old leaven, neither the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Mm-hmm. And then it speaks about being filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. See, those are accompaniments. Yes. You can't give thanks effectively mm-hmm. or make a request effectively without giving thanks. See, that it to go along. You can't draw near to God without assurance. You can't believe without rejoicing with joy and speaking full of glory and so forth. Have the accompaniments.
Yeah.
They enclosed this great multitude of fish.
Yeah.
As I mentioned, the directive was let your nets down, not cast them. I got a picture of a man casting a net. I thought it'd be interesting to see, you know. It took a lot of exertion to cast the net, and then you had to pull it in and cast it out again. So by letting it down, the school must have been waiting there for it to swim into the net, so to speak. Yes.
He did make it easy on them, but I think it's easier to lower the net down.
Oh, yeah.
than to cast the net.
You have more energy to haul in this great catch. Now as they hauled it in, their net break. Yes, Brother Aaron.
About the do all things to the glory of God can really be used as kind of a club or a weight against people. But he's thinking about it in this text, this was the doing it unto the Lord was the opportunity for the great catch. See, in everything could be everything that's not done unto the Lord is an opportunity for the flesh.
Yes. Right.
So if this could be discouraging if it's not done unto the Lord, but also success is a temptation if you're not doing it unto the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
So as we live unto the Lord, then you see that when it appears like everything's against you, you'll be able to see how the Lord's working in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Now as they were lifted it up, their net break. Technically it began to break. It's the idea. Get to tear apart. Mm-hmm. Now this complicated the whole matter, see.
Yeah.
First they've been toiling all night, so they were tired to begin with. Now fatigued in the flesh, they've caught more fish than they expected. Their net's coming apart. But the thought apparently didn't occur to them to let the net go.
Yeah, yeah.
The thought apparently never occurred to them to do that. Maybe they did reason this way. We caught this miraculous catch. Maybe the Lord will give us strength to bring it in.
Yeah.
That's how we should think.
Uh-huh. Yes.
It's possible to pray for God to do great things, and He does them. You say, what are they going to do? How are we going to... We thought we were going to have two people. We had 50. What are we going to do? Well, you do what these people do. You say, we're not going to let any of them loose.
That's right.
What a lesson to be learned there is here.
Yeah.
One thing we learned about brevity, it always produces small catches. Whatever can be said about it. You would think a person to be deficient in mental aptitude if he determined to gather sufficient grain for a week and thought he'd do it in a minute, you know. Think about that. Now, brevity. There's times you can be brief and get a lot, like, Lord, save me. Like when you're sinking, you know. That's a different kind of a situation. But a large supply generally requires some gathering. There's no small number of people who are spending less and less time hearing and ingesting the word, but they want all the benefits. It doesn't work this way, brother.
Right.
It doesn't work this way.
Uh-huh.
And somehow this has got to be communicated to people. Meager spiritual appetites won't sustain you. They just won't. This, of course, is in stark contrast with the world. See, the world. They never really get enough to sustain them in Christ. This is in stark contrast to heavenly directives. As newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the Word. This doesn't mean desire the simple things of the Bible. That's not the milk of the Word.
Yeah.
I think everybody here knows this, but I remember when people didn't know this.
Mm-hmm.
Thought the milk of the Word was the simple stuff. The milk of the Word is the Word.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
The meat of the Word is what's in the Word, the implications of it, so forth.
Amen.
So newborn babes, they desire, boy, they got this insatiable desire. They'll chew on their foot, you know.
Yeah.
Well, it's the way they are. Now, like newborn babes, you desire the sincere milk of the Word.
Brother, would it be correct to say that the meat of the Word is the understanding?
Yes, that's exactly, yeah, that is it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You can use it, in other words.
Yes.
Yeah, you can use it, employ it. Well, what are they going to do? They call in their partners. They beckoned, you know. Beckon their partners. Signal to them that they should come and help them. Come and help us. This, we got more we can handle. Come over and help us here. They've been fishing all night too.
Uh-huh.
Their partners have been fishing all night too.
Yeah.
And they've been cleansing their nets too. But they apparently got in their boat and got out there right away.
Yeah.
It appears as though Jesus had launched onto the deep. That was the only boat was Peter's. But now they got another one. They came out there and they came and filled both the boats.
Yeah.
It's a big catch. Fill both of them. And remember, these are not little rowboats.
Yeah.
So they say that these are probably at least 10, 13 people.
Uh-huh.
So they fill both the boats, and the boats begin to sink.
Mm.
Now, they didn't start throwing some fish overboard.
Yeah.
See, now when the ship was in danger, and Paul's in the ship, they were in danger, they were throwing stuff that was in the ship. They started throwing it.
Uh-huh.
Nobody's throwing anything off this ship.
Yeah.
you can see they valued this. I mean, if Jesus causes a great catch to be made, then the men aren't about to be throwing them back into the water. Now, I think God in his mercy kept those boats afloat. And I imagine it's pretty apparent. Now, what do you suppose would happen if the church is joined together with one heart and one soul out of devotion to Jesus to catch men? I mean, nobody can imagine what the impact of this. See, division is stopped helping to unload the fish. See, it's stopped, that sort of thing. There is coming a time, however. Now, God's shown in this event here, he's shown he can do this. He reduced it down to a micro view and showed you, I can do this.
Amen.
I can make tired people willing to work a little more.
Yes, that's right.
Huh? Yeah. I can do that. He said there's going to come a time, I will give them one heart and one way, that they may fear me forever for the good of them and their children after them. Mm-hmm. I will give them one heart. I will put a new spirit within you. I will take the stone heart out. Then will I turn unto the people a pure language, that they may call upon me the name of the Lord, to serve him with one consent. And many nations shall be joined to the Lord in that day, and then shall be my people. I will dwell in the midst of them. The Lord shall be king over all the earth. That day shall there be one Lord, and his name one. See? This is going to happen.
Yes, amen.
So God has shrunk it down so you could see it in a single event.
Yeah.
You know that by nature, this couldn't even happen on this small scale. By nature, this could not happen on even an ant scale. But God made it happen, and God can make it happen again.
Yeah.
Well, Simon Peter, he saw this, and something happens when you really see God work.
Yeah.
Boy, there's a light shines on in the inner person.
Mm-hmm.
And it illuminated. Peter saw this. He observed, whoa. This must have been something to see, huh?
Yeah.
Let down your net. You got so many fish you couldn't haul it in.
Yeah.
The people come and help. And there was even more than they thought. It filled both boats that began to sink. And they come to see, that's a lot to see. Peter saw it. And he fell down at Jesus' knees. See, that's what he saw. He saw this catch.
Yeah.
He didn't say, wow, what a catch this is. Oh, maybe we could do this tomorrow. He said, depart from me, O Lord, for I'm a sinful man. See, here's what happens. When light shines and the working of God is seen, it illuminates the person who sees it.
Amen.
Now, here's an example of it working on a congregational level. Paul gave this hypothetical case. If therefore the whole church be come together into one place, see, that's hard. There's few places that have actually got that done. Whole church become together in one place and all speak with tongues, and there come in those who are unlearned or unbelievers. Will they not say that ye are mad? Yeah, they would, and they do.
Yeah.
But if all prophesy, and there come in one that believeth not or one unlearned, he is convinced of all, he is judged of all, and thus are the secrets of his heart made manifest. And so falling down on his face, he will worship God and report that God is in you of a truth.
Mm-hmm.
Now here's what happened. All prophesy. We might call it a sharing session or whatever you want to call it. But God moved people to speak about something that was in that person.
Mm-hmm.
The people didn't know that's what they were saying. But they must have exposed what was in that person. It was a multiple witnesses. It wasn't just one person. And so he fell down. He said, I know God's here.
Yeah.
A couple of times this has happened here. Now I'll give you one example when it happened. Brother John Hill, one of his sons lived in Russia. His son had defected from the faith. And he came to visit Brother John and came to the assembly one Sunday night. And he testified at the assembly after it was over. He stood up and said that this is the real thing, and it reawakened in him. Mm-hmm. He stood up and acknowledged what this man said here. Was any of you here at that time? Oh, yeah. I mean, Brother Aaron was here. It was quite a night. But it was a demonstration of that. This is what happened to Peter. See, when a working of the Lord is seen as the working of the Lord, it shines a...
Yeah, that's right.
It shines a light, interior light, and it discovers things that mm-hmm. wouldn't be discovered otherwise. Depart from me, I'm a sinful man. Well, as you noted, the Lord didn't depart.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But you feel ill at ease. See, sin makes you feel ill at ease in the presence of the Lord.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you got to have, like, don't fear. You know, you got to have some word like that. Depart from me, O Lord. He doesn't say I'm a weak man, mm-hmm. I'm a sinful man.
Yeah.
Doesn't say I haven't always done what's right. He says I'm a sinful man. See,
yeah.
He calls it what it is.
Yeah.
He was contrasting himself with Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't say, but at least I'm better than Herod.
Yeah.
See? It's never wise or right to compare yourself with your peers. This is never good. It's why seeking moral reform, even if reform is necessary, is vastly inferior to conversion.
Yeah.
Amen.
If you can convert people, you've solved the
Amen.
Committing sin problem.
Amen. That's right.
Again,
yes.
You look around, you can always find somebody that's worse than you.
Oh, yeah.
But if you look at Jesus, then you will always find an example to look up to.
That's right. Amen.
Amen.
And then a little later we'll find that Peter even drugged the net in John 21. He single-handed drug a big loaded net, drug it in. And it says that he was astonished.
Mm-hmm.
Astonished here. Actually, his amazement seized him.
Mm.
We call it befuddled. In other words, what happened exceeded his capacity of understanding. He was awestruck, seized. He was in the grip of amazement.
Mm.
This was not an expression of faith.
Mm-hmm.
It was an expression of fear. We know that's the case because Jesus said, "Fear not." That's the first words he said. Fear, so this is an expression of fear.
Yeah.
If you were a strong person or an ingenious person, or you could think things out very well, you're very strong, very capable, one big exposure to God dries all that up.
Yeah.
You know there's nothing you can do about it at all. But as they say, Jesus did not depart. After the day of Pentecost, no apostle is ever said to be seized with amazement,
Amen.
Or to have marveled, or to have been astonished, or the old word astonied. Never happened. When Peter took that lame man by the hand and lifted him up, he didn't say, and Peter was amazed that he walked. You know?
Yeah.
That's right.
Amen.
And he had so also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, they were amazed too. So they were their partners. It was like a business, I gather. And Jesus says to them, first he says, Simon, don't be afraid. So that amazement, see, that was the crystallization of fear.
Mm-hmm.
Don't fear. From the words fear not occur 63 times in Scripture. Now to give you a little perspective, 48 of them are in Genesis through Malachi. 12 of them are in the Gospels. One of them is in Acts, and two are in Romans through Revelation. Does that tell you something about the impact of salvation?
Yeah.
Don't fear, from now on you're going to catch men.
Yeah.
The word translated catch means to take alive or to capture or to bring under control. Now, see, it's possible to fish all night and not catch anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So Jesus didn't say, you'll fish for men.
Yeah.
Although some versions do say it.
Uh-huh.
He did say, I'll make you fishers of men.
Mm-hmm.
But here he says, you'll catch them. You'll catch.
Yeah.
You'll catch men. Peter caught 3,000 men in the gospel net on the day of Pentecost. He caught them. You'll catch men. Now, I gather that they would catch men like they caught fish by divine direction.
Right. Yes.
Huh? Right?
Yes. Amen.
You try and do it on your own, you won't catch them. Yeah. If the church has learned anything, it's certainly by this time it ought to have learned that you can't cook up a program to catch men.
That's right. Yeah.
There's film strips, you know, used for catching men. There's books written how to catch men, but they just don't work.
Mm-hmm.
You'll say, Macedonia, that's the place to go. Antioch, Samaria, got the desert out there, that eunuch, they were catching men.
That's right.
By divine direction. Just like he told them where to drop their net,
that's right.
He told them where to preach the gospel.
Amen.
And when they had brought their ships to land, which must have taken some effort.
Uh-huh.
Now, Matthew's account reads a little bit different, but it's, we can harmonize these. But here's how Matthew gives this account.
Uh-huh.
Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren, Simon called Peter and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And he saith unto them, follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. And they straightway left their nets and followed him. And going on from thence, he saw two other brethren, James the son of Zebedee and John his brother, in a ship with Zebedee their father, mending their nets. And he called them, and they immediately left the ship and their father and followed him. See, so he doesn't bring up this catch of fish at all. Mark's account. Now, as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew his brother casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And Jesus said unto them, come ye after me, and I'll make you to become fishers of men. Straightway they forsook their nets and followed him. And when he had gone a little farther thence, he saw James the son of Zebedee and John his brother, who also were in the ship, mending their nets. And straightway he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the ship with the hired servants and went after him. Now you say, how do you put all that together? Well, Luke just takes when he was at the sea and the people were there. The other gospel writers have him going to he's going to the sea,
mm-hmm.
and on the way to the sea, he sees these men are still fishing out there.
Mm-hmm.
And then, it all blends together. What it is he's looking at it from different periods of time, but it's the same event.
Yeah.
Same event. It all ends up the same way. They forsook all and followed Jesus.
That's right.
Matthew says, and they immediately left the ship and their father and followed him.
Uh-huh.
Mark says, and straightway he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the ship with the hired servants and went after him.
Uh-huh.
And he stayed with them. So they concluded that if Jesus was going to make them catch men, they were going to have to be with him. I don't know that they thought it out in those words, but that's what they knew. They knew intuitively. If Jesus is going to really make us catch men, I'm going to make you catch men.
Uh-huh.
Then we'll have to be with him. So they say goodbye to their business. This was a business.
That's right.
A joint business, evidently.
Yeah.
Matthew points out that Jesus said to them, follow me. Mark reports that he said, come ye after me. So Jesus, after this event, headed off again. He didn't stay on the shore for the next group of people. Matthew says they followed Jesus immediately, adding that James and John left the ship and their father.
Mm-hmm.
Mark says they did so straightway, right, an immediate response. Luke says when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all. So their father, James and John, their father, would have the mm-hmm. have the fish yeah. for the business, you know, and yeah. so forth. So there's no contradiction in any accounts at all. They all fit together perfectly well. But it's quite a and what God is doing here, he's gathered, Jesus is gathering men he's going to make apostles.
Yeah.
He's starting to put them all together now. Yeah. Now the next you're going to get Matthew, and he's gradually building this nucleus of people. Uh-huh. There's going to be the church is going to be built upon them, mm-hmm. upon their teaching.
That's right.
So it's a. We're being made privy to the working of the Lord here, and it's marvelous to behold. These incidents here are like a piece of a puzzle. Mm-hmm. They're actually, you can study them, there's a lot in that incident, but you've got to set it in the, put it in the, in yeah. the whole picture, it's got to yeah. fit in there. Amen. And there's something you're learning about Jesus here, and about God's ways and manners, and about what happens when Jesus really speaks, when Jesus focuses his attention on somebody,
yeah.
what happens? You remember the psalmist, he'd say, look upon me. See, he kind of knew this. If the Lord will just look at me,
yeah, yeah.
it'll resolve a lot
Amen.
Of... Now, my prayer is that I want to be part of people coming to know this. Mm-hmm. I know what it did to me when I began to
yes.
know it. I'm still learning it. Mm-hmm. It changes the way you assess things, I'll tell you.
Mm-hmm.
All right, any of you have a word you'd like to add tonight, Brother Jason?
That response of Peter is so instructive. Away from me, Lord, I'm a sinful man. And of course, that was true.
Yeah.
It was true. Peter wasn't any different than in any one of us, really, if you just boil it down to his humanity. I mean, he wasn't a wicked man. I don't think you could substantiate he was a wicked man.
No, no.
But that was the right assessment. Jesus
yeah.
didn't contradict him.
No. That's right.
And this shows us that there is no person that in and of themselves can do the work of God apart from Jesus.
That's right.
The only way anybody can engage in the work of the Lord is by some kind of divine equipment or equipping and grace that's given. And that was true of Peter and the apostles. As high up as they are in the ranks, so to speak, the church is built on the foundation of the apostles. But none of these men in and of themselves
right.
were able to do it. And that's what this
yeah.
account is teaching them
Amen.
And teaching us as well. So,
yeah.
But the church, see, the church has a... Now, you accented that some people like to put Peter down, but on the other hand, the church has a very bad habit of exalting men.
Yeah,
yeah.
yeah. We know one church that exalted Peter. And
yeah, yeah. Not just the apostles, but just men today,
yeah. mm-hmm.
as if somehow the church is riding on the power of really talented men,
yeah.
which
yeah.
is not the case.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think anyone who becomes acutely aware of Christ will come to the same conclusion Peter did.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's the closer you get to Jesus,
That's
the more
right.
the more you see how you need him.
That's right. You know, this no doubt was the largest catch that Peter had ever caught. And here he is in the end walking away from it.
That's right.
Now, and yet, very, very well may be, and I think it is this is what it took for Peter to walk away,
yeah.
to be able to connect that this is the Christ, this is the one. Well, then he could let go of this because he was going to catch,
right.
he
Amen.
Was going to go with Jesus.
Amen.
But see, what would it take to walk away from that? Well, Jesus knew what it would take. I'm convinced Jesus does exactly what you need. He works in you exactly what is needful for you to walk away from the world.
Amen. Amen.
I'm always amazed at how Jesus doesn't miss any details.
Yes,
one
right,
event
right.
like this, he takes care of a lot of different
yeah.
things. How he involved his partners
yeah.
in the catch too. They had to call
yes.
for his partners. So Jesus involved the whole bunch was
That's
involved
right.
in that.
Amen.
So
yeah.
he taught so many things there, and I also was impressed. Also, I mentioned this also that he didn't require them to cast a net, but they'd been
mm-hmm.
fishing all night. So
yeah.
I thought that was a sensitive thing to do, Amen. Accessible to. The lamb just lower than that. He could have had him cast it, you know. Yeah. But also, now he left his father and his hired servants with an astounding
catch.
Yes. That this is sort of like, now this will get you, you know, told you, tied you till. But anyway, I teach, that's what I'm saying is that this is over and over and over. Jesus doesn't miss any.
He's thorough.
Nothing falls to the cracks with the Lord. And he's still that way.
This helps us to understand that when you walk with Jesus, it addresses a lot of other things that need to be addressed. But if you turn the spotlight on those things, see, you made a big, big mistake.
Yeah.
Yes, Rachel.
A person who doesn't have faith can't understand the Word of God because they don't have the faith to understand.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I'm persuaded that this reaction of Peter is part of the reason why Jesus chose it.
Yes.
This godly reaction.
Yes.
Of recognition, submission, and willingness at this sign. Like you said earlier, that he knew, he met Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
You get the impression from the record that they kind of followed him periodically for some weeks.
Yeah.
And this is the point of the vision,
right,
here and now. And this is why he chose Peter, because he was this kind of man.
Amen.
And he would make him more so that kind of man.
He named him in Cephas, because by interpretation is a stone. That'd be like boulder stone, not pebble stone.
Yeah, that's right.
But it's something, it's like Satan is still trying to accuse Peter, like he tried to sift him. He's still trying to bring disgrace on Peter, or as a Catholicism, to unduly exalt him.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
I like to think of that term. You know, the Lord said Satan is asked to sift you. Satan really wanted to destroy him.
Oh, yeah.
Jesus turned it into a sifting.
Yeah.
He thought he could get rid of his virtues, but instead the sifting got rid of his lack of virtue.
Right.
How about that?
Yeah.
That's God. See, God's behind everything.
Amen.
That is not what Satan intended to do.
Yeah.
He didn't intend to provoke Peter to repent.
Yeah.
Well, he used Satan to sift something out of him.
That's right.
He sifted him all right. He removed some bad things.
Amen. How can he win? Yeah, Brother Judah.
Seems to me like fishers of men, you catch men, that's not much of a mechanical process. I'm not experienced enough in having a part in converting people to Christ, but it does seem to me like you can't go through these 12 steps and save somebody every time.
You're exactly right.
Jude said,
some think you can.
On some have compassion making a difference, and others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire.
Yeah.
And
amen.
In my experience of that, it has been having compassion and making a difference.
Yeah.
But saying fishers of men doesn't mean go out and choose 15 people and save them all using the same method, and just to get them inside of the church is the approach that I've heard talked about here. Just get them inside the four walls, and that's all that matters. But fishers of men includes saving them from the wrath of God, or at least playing a part in that, and then continuing to nurture them in the admonition of the Lord that with the new life that they have. So it goes further than just conversion. It keeps going in the growth that person has after that.
This would be like a systematized way. It'd be like Jesus saying, now Peter, go out there and catch 2 boatloads of fish. You keep on doing it now, you get 2 boatloads. Yes, Brother Matthew.
Yeah, I thought about this too. When they back into their partners. Sometimes we have this experience in the assembly sometimes that a brother or sister comes with a full net.
Amen.
And as a group, we got to have to help to draw that thing in.
Back in the pahe.
Help
over here to bring this in. Yeah, that's good.
I'll tell you something else. You know, now Peter didn't say, now we've been fishing wrong.
Yeah.
We've been casting our nets. We've been lowering our nets out of the ship.
Oh,
that's good.
New system.
That's it.
I like this point too that you brought out about including the accompaniments.
Oh yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So I was thinking how faith really works in this. These different
Amen.
Scriptures you brought out. Be careful for nothing but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving.
Yeah.
So if you've ever experienced, I know we all have, like toiling all night, and I'm not just saying about maybe to prepare something to present, but about anything in your life
That's
of
right.
faith. Maybe you know the Lord has said something on this matter and you're toiling and you say, Lord, I still don't see it, but then you do these things.
That's right.
And you trust the Lord,
That's
and then you
right.
can sit, then you get the catch.
Yes,
so
with
it's,
Thanksgiving.
Yes.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
So it's a wonderful thing to be able to know these scriptures. And to, that's
yes.
why it's important to preach these things,
yeah.
too, because as you do, this is how you're built up. The body's built up. And you're able to grow in your faith.
Amen.
By this.
And there's, a, I guess I'm saying, but there's a lot of these in Scripture.
Uh-huh.
And it just was kind of a fresh insight that
yes,
about the accompaniments.
Amen.
I mean, Peter could have told the Lord, now look, if you just keep letting us catch Jesus, we can finance your ministry. We'll just stay here and fish, and we'll just send you some money.
Those women won't need to follow you. Yeah.
I'll see later, Jesus is going to teach him, I can use fish for money, but it's
yeah.
going to be a different way.
That's right.
Usually they were out pursuing the fish.
That's
this time the Lord brought them.
Yes,
that's right.
To them.
So,
Amen.
You'll also be fishers of men.
Yeah.
That is exactly what the Lord did. God brought people
yes,
to
that's
them
right.
that's
who
right.
wanted the gospel as they went out.
That's what happened the day of Pentecost.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Got
yeah.
the nets.
Mm-hmm.
Just let down the
right.
net.
Right. So it's not saying you're going to work and work to bring people to Christ.
Amen.
Uh-huh.
He's going to bring them.
That's right.
He did say, go and make disciples.
Yeah.
yeah.
But there's...
Yeah.
The generally accepted American methodology
yeah.
uh-huh.
is not necessarily
but then
what
it works out. You read the Acts, he told them where to go.
Yeah.
Remember, the Holy Spirit appears that separates Saul and Barnabas.
Yeah, yeah.
Barnabas and Saul for the
yeah.
work where it's so he was going to tell them where to go.
They started to go north, and the Spirit of Jesus said no. They started
that's
to go
right.
south, and he said no, and so they continued west.
So that's the secret.
So
yeah.
That's why... In an assembly of believers, sensitivity to Christ has to be cultured.
Uh-huh. Yes.
This is something everybody grows
Amen.
In. And you can't make another person do this.
Uh-huh.
But we have to feed things and say things that assist people to grow, be close to God. Then they can be directed, see?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
I was thinking about the boy Samuel earlier tonight. In view of all these things, that he needed to be directed whenever the Lord called him, but he hadn't known the word of the Lord at that point. He was so young that Eli had to tell him,
"That's right,
it's the Lord, and this is
yeah.
next time you hear it, this is what you need to do."
That's
and
right.
then he was able to receive, and he became acquainted with the Lord
yeah.
through that
yeah.
help and instruction. And so you mentioned these inclinations, these leadings of the Spirit that the Lord will impress upon you.
Yeah.
That those are things that he's leading you to do. All of us have to become acquainted with him
yes.
in those ways that he leads us.
Amen.
And so we want to give one another the benefit of imparting
yeah.
what we have received from the Lord
yeah,
and directing
yeah.
in all of these assembly times.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Then Samuel, he was the best judge, and he was the first of the great prophets that foretold Christ. So he was properly directed when young, look what happened.
The reason now, from a practical standpoint, is the reason why they had to go into the deeper water. Jesus had this large amount of fish. There
yeah.
simply wasn't room
no.
for these fish in
yeah.
the shallow water where they were at.
Now,
yeah.
see if
you see
the
so.
Only way, I we're reading about it, that sometimes this school of fish will come up to the surface and they cover an acre.
Yeah.
So now how are you gonna gather?
Yeah.
You'd have to troll and troll and troll, you know, just... So there, so he just hit down the depths. There were shoals of sand. Those are sandbars. I understand there were shoals of fish in astounding numbers to this day. It's just, they say it's just astounding numbers. And so that's where he just separated a couple of net fulls.
Yeah.
brought them over. The other time, they just cast your net on the right side over there. They're waiting for you over there.
Yeah, that's right.
It also teaches you that the Lord doesn't wait till you're rested up to
that's
use
right.
you.
Yes. Amen.
Sometimes he may, like sometimes he'll say, let's depart for a while, you know, and take a rest because we've been busy, we haven't had time to eat. So he did that one time. But then there's other times where they were plumb worn out, and they had, then they got the biggest kits they ever got.
That's right,
But working together, they could get it in.
Yes, amen.
Sometimes this will happen in the assembly, this will happen. There'll be like two boatloads of stuff.
Yeah.
Everybody's got to help.
Amen.
Yeah. As we ask these comments, that's what we're asking for. Help us help.
That's right.
Help us bring the net in, reel the net in
that's
here
right.
so we can all get all the fish.
Yeah.
Yes.
What you just said there, the disciples were wore out and then they got their biggest catch. I thought for runners will run for a certain amount of time and they'll start hitting a wall. They'll get tired and they'll get weary, and then they'll get a
second wind.
At the point where they think, I can't do this anymore, then they get a new reserve of energy.
Well, yeah.
Nothing is going to come to you easy in the kingdom.
Yes,
it is called a good fight of faith for a reason.
Amen.
And we strive to obtain the prize. It's not smooth sailing all the way.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, Brother Tony.
I'm thankful for what Sister Barb just said. I had something on my mind, and she just provided me with a boatload.
Yeah.
I just discovered something that in a situation of my own.
Yeah.
Thankful for what she just said.
Someone over here?
Yeah. Jesus' word was always followed up by something miraculous, by something extraordinary. Remember, he said, fill the water pots with water.
Yeah, that's right.
Uh-huh. After that, that was wine. Remember, he said, stretch forth thine hand.
Yeah.
He said, take up your bed and walk.
Yeah.
It always,
Amen.
Anytime that was followed, faith got a hold of that.
Yeah, something happened.
Something happened.
Yeah.
All right, I think we'll close there. Our Heavenly Father, we're grateful for this account. And the many things that are seen in it. We want to make ourselves available for your use, Heavenly Father, whatever it takes. And we are grateful you give us examples like this of how you do, in fact, use your people for noble causes. We pray that you do so with us. In Jesus' name, amen.